have one person over there. But it is good to gather in the house of the Lord together. Let's stand up. And before we do anything, we want to direct our hearts and our hands and our voices to the Lord. So we're going to lift up our voices and we're going to welcome this new year with singing His praise. Amen?
We are seeing voices. We are an ocean of your praise. And gathered under we cannot be contained and gathered under
promise, God of the future, you see beginning and end. God of the rescue, God of the breakthrough, how great is your faithfulness. That's right. You're not done yet. No eye, no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough, your promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. God God in my seeking, God in my dreaming, you put a song in my soul. God in the working, God I'm believing, you'll do the impossible. You're not done yet. No eyes ever seen, no ears ever heard, no mind could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough, your promise we will trust, and greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. You're up to something right now. Come on, church, let's sing. You're doing a new thing right now. Let your glory, God, let your glory come down. Come on. Don't hold back. Don't hold back. You're up to something right now. You're doing a new thing right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't.
Light it up. There's something so special about your presence. But too often, Lord, do I just enjoy it and my heart isn't broken for those who don't have it. Let this song not just be words that we get excited about or that we lift our voice to, but let it be true, Lord, God, would you awaken your people? Would you awaken me? So that we can bring life to the city around us. Set a fire in my heart, God. Come awaken your people. Come awaken this city. God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. I hear chains hit the ground. God of revival, pour it out in my heart today. Come awaken your people. Come awaken this city. God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. Hear chains hit the ground. God of revival, pour it out, pour it out.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken.
So you tell them.
So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your praise.
Lord. We're just coming as we are today, Lord. With all of our brokenness, with all of our messiness, Lord. We just come as we are, Lord. And we thank you, God, that you meet us here. You meet us here, right where we're at. And I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your new mercies. I thank you for your unfailing, your unchanging love. Thank you, God, that you're trustworthy. Thank you, God, that I can place my hope in you, Lord. We love you, Lord. And you're the one this is all about. You're the one that this is all for. So none of us want to get in the way. But we want you to receive the glory that you're due, the glory that you deserve. So we love you, Lord. And we ask that you would continue just to move. We really mean this when we say it. Would you do what only you can do? Would you do what you want to do in our hearts today, God? We pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So good to worship together, Harvest.
Yeah. You
can take a seat. Yeah.
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. I'm so glad that you've joined us today. My name is Ramirez Moody, and I serve as the associate pastor of our Young Adults and Compassion Ministries at our Rolling Meadows campus. On this first Sunday of 2021, we'd love to know where you're watching from today. So you can let us know in the chat or in the comments. And if this is your first time with us, I want to give you a special welcome. No matter where you're joining us from today, we are so glad that you're here. Whether you're new or you come every week, we want to invite you to check in. You can do that on this page through the link in the comments or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We'd love to know where you are today or how we can be praying for you this week. Before we leave the celebration of Christmas, I want you to see a few highlights from our live event, Come and See, a Christmas Experience in Lights that took place a couple of weeks ago. Check this out. On this first Sunday of the new year, our Harvest pastors are preaching in person on each of our campuses across Chicagoland. Here in our online service, we will join the Rolling Meadows campus and hear from Pastor John Smith, who serves as the co-campus pastor. Together, we will look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, in a message entitled, Hope for a New Year. I want to encourage you to get your Bible and be ready to dig into God's Word together later in this service. Next Sunday, we launch into a new three-week teaching series with Pastor Eddie Hoagland. He's calling it, Yes, I Will. Expect it for how God will use this series in our lives and in our church. Harvest, as we start a new year, we all want hope, right? Hope is available. Hope is personal. It's practical. and true hope is found in Jesus Christ. I'm inviting you to join us for a free online class on hope in the month of January. You can take one or take them all. They're all available online. They include hope for my marriage, hope for my family, hope in my struggle, hope in my finances, hope in Jesus Christ, and a habit for hope that's a daily Bible reading plan. I know that's a lot of information, but these classes start this week. Get all of the details and register today at harvestnow.info. Harvest, we thank the Lord for His faithfulness to His work through this church, through the giving of so many of you. As we start this new year, I am reminded of the truth found in Matthew chapter 6, verse 21, which says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Our prayer is that your heart is where you see God working. As many of you know, there are four ways to give. You can give online on this page or through the link in the comments on the Harvest Bible Chapel app or through text or even mailing your gift to the Rolling Meadows campus. Will you join me in prayer? Lord, we just thank you for another opportunity to come together and worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we thank you for everything that you've done for us, but we're thankful for everything that you are still yet to do this year. We thank you for providing all of the needs of our church. And Lord, we just pray that as we open your word today and you begin to speak to our hearts on where hope lies, Lord, we just pray that it will penetrate the hearts of those who are feeling hopeless right now. And so God, we just say, have your way in this service and in our church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's go ahead and stand together as we sing this new song.
This is a house of worship. This is a place of praise, where every demon trembles, where we proclaim your name. This is a house of healing. Our hearts are full of faith. You have our full attention. You have the final say. So come alive in the name of Jesus. Come alive in the name of Jesus. This is a house of
Jesus Christ.
Holy Spirit, we open our hearts to your word right now. We open our hearts and we say, God, would you speak to us? God, I still believe that you're speaking. I still believe that you're working and you're moving. That all things in my life, Lord, you're working out for my good. That comes from the heart of compassion that you have. So, Lord, I open myself completely to you, holding nothing back, leaving nothing to the side. I ask that you would shape me and mold me through the teaching of your word and the leading of your Holy Spirit. God, we pray all these things, we sing all these things, and we glorify you through the blood and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Amen, church. Let's go ahead and take a seat as we continue.
Well, good morning, Harvest. Happy New Year. We made it, 2021, and it's good to be in the house of the Lord to start off this new year together. For those of you who are watching online, we're so delighted you're with us today. Isn't it good to be able to have a church that meets in person and online? I think it's great. What a great blessing this is in the day that we live. Well, 2020 was quite the year, wasn't it? And I don't want us to be a church that says, I want to forget 2020, because there's a lot of things that we can look back with fondness, and there's a lot of things that we can learn from 2020. Man, think about all the ways that we as a church got to see the Lord do a good work. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. I don't want us to miss that for a minute. Yeah, life looked a lot different. We made some major adjustments. Think about the weddings that you thought you were invited to, but then it was just for family. Anniversaries, birthday parties. My mom turned 90 this year. Wow. Celebrations happened in the midst of a lot of chaos and confusion. You know what? Hope doesn't just happen because a calendar year changes. Hope doesn't happen because circumstances or situations change. Hope, for us to know who are here today, is found in Jesus Christ, and his name is greatly to be praised. We have hope in Jesus. You know, there was a man, his name was Major Smith, no relation to me. But way back in the day, this gentleman was a leader of an Australian army. And he was partnering with the U.S. and some other troops over in Vietnam. And he was going to help bring a platoon of guys over. And he brought 108, but they were very inexperienced men. They had never been in battle before. Most of them, 20 years of age, being thrown into a situation that seemed, wow, over their heads. But the major brought them out there and he divided them all up into different areas and regions, and they were ready for the battle that was in front of them, or so they thought. And then they realized that there were 2,000 troops in this one area just over them. Can you imagine that? 108 of you divided up into different regions, and then all of a sudden you realize you're outnumbered. You feel swarmed. You feel surrounded. You feel like there is no hope that we are getting out of this. So they call back to the base and they tell them the situation that they're in. And while they're talking, their communication device gets shot and there's nothing going back to the home base. The major has to make a decision. Do I send more troops in to help this seemingly diminished or depleted or decimated crew, or do we just move on? And hearing that, there's some question of what's going to take place. A platoon that's nearby runs over with another communication device to learn what they can find, to see if it is totally wiped out or if there's any hope at all for these troops. And the next thing that they hear, many down, but still some fighting. Many around, ammo is low, please send help. But the home base doesn't decide to send help because it's going to be more bloodshed. So what goes on in these men's mind? They think hope is diminished. They think hope is depleted. They think hope is gone. But one of the platoons goes over and he just tries to cheer them on for what they can do. And the next thing that happens, at the last moment possible, hope arrives. Bombs come down just beyond their perimeter, and the troops that were on the attack now go on the retreat. Hope is found for these troops. Troops that were discouraged, injured, believing their last day had come, the closest platoon came by and rescued them and brought them to safety. Maybe that story sounds a little bit like what your life was like in 2020. It does a little bit for like mine. Whether you're in this room or you're online, you can maybe identify. You felt overwhelmed. You felt lost a little bit of everywhere. You felt like communication was down and you didn't know if there was hope. You lost your job. You lost your house. You lost a family member. Maybe your wife left you. Maybe you got COVID. You just look and you say, man, this year was so challenging. Maybe it was e-learning. You're a student who was like, man, this has been terrible for me. Or maybe you're a student that you don't know how college is going to be possible because the sport that you played was canceled. Well, I want you to know, hope looked like it was never going to come. Those troops felt swarmed and surrounded, and maybe you did in 2020, but here's what I want you to hear. In the midst of situations and circumstances that are sometimes totally out of our control, we have hope because of Jesus. No matter if you feel like that was the craziest roller coaster ride that had twists and turns that you could never see, your life, if you know Jesus, is anchored in the hope of Jesus that he is always with you. His presence never leaves you. Do you realize that the presence of the Lord is with us always? Those of us who know Jesus, there's always hope. Church, let's not forget that as we walk into 2021, the calendar year has changed. But Jesus never changes. He is always hope. He is always our anchor. He is always the one that we can cling to when situations and circumstances, when life feels like we're being swarmed and surrounded, Jesus is with us. Tell somebody that you're sitting next to as you turn your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 1. There's hope. There's hope for all of us in Jesus. Let's look at 1 Peter 1, verse 3, because this passage gives us some amazing truth that we can hang our hats on for this year, 2021. Let's not miss these three truths. There's three truths we should always thank the Heavenly Father for: the hope of eternal life that we have. Look at verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again, a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that's imperishable, undefiled, unfading, and kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Peter was writing to a group of people. They were the elect exiles. Exiles. Think about that. This was not a common time for them. They had been kicked out of, they were persecuted, they were suffering. And Peter goes on in this book to let them know, and he gives them in every chapter, you're going to face this, and you're going to see this. And he identifies with different ways that persecution and suffering will come in life. But Jesus, who is the hope that we can anchor our life on. When we can't see some of the things coming our way, we can be anchored in that. And so let's pray and ask the Lord to teach us from his word today. Lord, we are so thankful for this hope that we have in you, this hope that is eternal. In fact, Lord, we are asking that we will see these opportunities in the midst of opposition, in the midst of suffering, that we get to live out our faith before a lost and dying world, before other family and friends, before other fellow believers, that you, that hope might be seen in you because you are the true hope. Father, you are not done yet. You are not done with any one of us, and you're not done with our church, and we're looking forward to seeing what you're gonna do in this year. So Father, today fill us with the hope from your word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, the big idea for us today is we'll be more capable of praising the Heavenly Father for the hope of eternal life when we constantly remind ourselves of these three truths. Write this first one down. I have hope because of the means of my salvation. I have hope because of the means of my salvation. And what does it say we should do? Bless the Lord. Yes, situations and circumstances are coming, but don't lose your heavenly perspective of this thing here. We have hope because of the means of our salvation. He starts off by saying blessed. I love the fact that our service, we just spent time blessing and adoring the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, because that's what we have to do, and that's what Peter is telling these people. Listen, I know you are in an unfamiliar place in a time that you didn't see this was coming, but I'm telling you, people, there's hope because of the means of your salvation. So bless the Lord. Our Father is worthy of blessing. Our Father is worthy of praise. He wants that emotion to well up inside of us, and he wants us to share that freely. Bless the Lord in the midst of some of the pain and suffering that we're going through. You aren't going through this storm. You aren't going through this roller coaster ride on your own. The presence of the Lord is with you, so bless the Lord. What a great reminder to get our head and our heart in that mindset. As we walk into this year, no matter what's in front of us, those of us who know Jesus, we can bless the Lord through challenges and circumstances. Our hope is found in Jesus. You know, this isn't new to Peter. This isn't new to the Bible. I would love for you to flip back a couple pages. I'm gonna start reading, but I hope you hear the theme of what was shared in Psalm 103, what we should do when we see challenges coming our way, to be reminded to get our head in the right part of the game and to bless the Lord. Psalm 103, listen to what David said. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Let's bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits, who forgives your iniquity, who heals your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good so that your youth can be renewed on the eagles. Look at verse 10. He does not deal with us accordingly to our sins, nor repay us to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is the steadfast love to those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. Verse 17, but the steadfast love of the Lord from everlasting to everlasting, those who fear him, and his righteousness to his children's children. Look at how he does verse 20, 21, and 22. Bless the Lord, bless the Lord, bless the Lord. It's repeated throughout Scripture that we are supposed to be a people because of our hope and salvation. We can bless the Lord, and that's a mindset and a heart set to have as we walk into this year, and we might not know all the things that are gonna be in front of us, but he calls us as a people because of the meaning of our salvation is so deep to bless the Lord. So let's be a church that's all about that. Why? Because of his great mercy. Bless the Lord because of his great mercy, found in verse 3. This mercy is like nothing we could experience here on this earth. This is a great mercy that only God could provide, that we might be able to have a life forever. Bless the Lord. According to his great mercy, he's caused us to be born again. God provided mercy that we might be saved. God provided mercy for all of us who are hearing the word of God this morning, that we might be saved, that we might be drawn to him, that we might have the means of salvation. Wayne Grudem put it this way. He says, no foreknowledge of the fact that we would believe, no foreseeing of any desirableness or merit on our part is mentioned here or anywhere in Scripture when indicating God's ultimate reason for salvation. It's simply according to his great mercy, he saved us. I have hope because of the means of salvation. Jesus rescued me, and he wants to rescue you, and that's where hope can be found. He's caused us to be born again. What a great hope that we have, that we can be born again, changed, spiritually anew, fresh start. Think about when Jesus is talking to Nicodemus, and Nicodemus is wondering, how can I be born again? Do I have to go back to my mother from birth? And he's like, no. And Jesus explains to him that truly, truly, I tell you, that unless one is born again of water and of spirit, you'll never see the kingdom of heaven. And then the most familiar verse in the Bible, for God so loved the world that he gave his son, that whoever would believe in him would have everlasting life. That means of salvation is what brings great hope. Do you have that means of salvation? Do you have hope in Christ? Last week, if you were here, or maybe you looked at the service online, you saw the salvation story of Martin and Rosalind. And they told of they were lost, then they found who Jesus was and the message of hope, and they put their complete faith and trust in Jesus. January 3rd, 2021. The means of salvation is available to all, and that's what gives hope. Situations and circumstances, they're all gonna change, but your anchor of hope, the means of salvation, is only in Jesus. Do you have hope in that? Listen, if you're watching online today and you've never put your complete faith and trust in Jesus, I would encourage you to get to your phone out and to text follow to 797979. And you who are here in this room today, maybe it's because of the new year you found yourself in church, or maybe you've been in church for years, but you've never understood the means of salvation and putting your complete faith and trust in Jesus. This is a day when you can be saved and have the greatest hope of all eternity. I have hope because of the means of salvation. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old is gone, the new has come. We can live that this year before a lost and dying world. We can live that in a way that people can be drawn to Jesus because of the hope that you have because of the means of your salvation. Well, a living hope through the resurrection from the dead. Why does he use that phrase? Well, Jesus, he came to earth and he lived a life and he died a death, but he rose again. And that makes our hope even more meaningful. Jesus conquered death. Jesus is alive. And so he says, a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Dr. V said this, God caused us to be born again with the result that we have hope that is alive. And he did this through, by means of, the resurrection of Jesus. 2 points you should write down about this. Jesus rose from the dead. He is alive. That's where your hope is, in a living Savior who lives today. 1 Corinthians 15:3 says that Christ died for sins according to the Scriptures, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. I believe that to be true, and that gives me hope. Second thing you should write down is Jesus will unite us with him again. John 11 says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet he shall live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. We have hope everlasting, a means of salvation, hope in Christ. Don't ever forget that. That's your anchor, is the means of your salvation. Well, God's plan is amazing. Someone can go from lost to found, blind to having sight, dead to alive. Where are you at today? Do you know Jesus? Do you have this hope in the means of salvation? Don't leave today without getting that settled. That's a super, super important thing for all of us to understand as we walk into this year. Hope because of the means of salvation. Well, if you know Jesus, I also want us to grow in Jesus. And so Pastor Ramirez talked about a plan that we can grow in this hope. And I think the greatest way that we can grow in hope is not just by being in community and being as a church and living together, but we can spend time in God's word together. So you can go to harvestnow.info, and I really want to challenge you. Pastor Ramirez mentioned reading through the Old Testament in 90 days. Go for it. But I just want to challenge you to something a little bit easier. Let's go through the New Testament in 90 days. So that plan is ready for you there. I've already started. It's not too late to start. It's 3 chapters a day. 3 chapters a day will take you less than 10 minutes, and you'll have a full day to digest it, but you will get pointed to the hope in Jesus. And I guarantee you will see the blessing and the anchor of hope in the means of salvation, and you will grow in your hunger and thirst for righteousness for Jesus. Would you join me? I've invited several guys in our church to join me, and I hope you will. Go on, get the reading plan, download it, it's on YouVersion, and let's spend these 90 days feasting on God's word and growing in our hope inside the word of the Lord. Well, a second important phrase for us to know today as we consider hope is this: I have hope because of the results of my salvation. This is such a powerful section. He's gonna give them something that's gonna be mind-blowing, and I don't want us to miss it for 1 minute. I have hope because of the results of my salvation. A living hope to an inheritance. A living hope to inheritance, that is what? He gives us some descriptions: imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven. What does that look like? Why does he mention inheritance? Well, he mentions inheritance because these people probably just lost everything as exiles. These Jewish people and some Greek people, they understood what inheritance was, and they probably had all of their earthly inheritance probably taken right from them because of the pain and the suffering and the persecution that they were experiencing. How many of you have ever received an inheritance? Anybody received an inheritance? Maybe you set up your inheritance. You know, it's super important to understand inheritance. It's something that we're leaving for somebody else. We make a plan and we're like, I wanna leave this for these people here. Sherry and I set one up in 2020, and one niece is gonna get a 2003 car and one niece is gonna get a 2006 car. Not much for them, but our earthly inheritances pale in comparison to the inheritance that the Lord has set aside for us. And we, who are believers, are heirs of an inheritance from the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Can you just imagine what that inheritance looks like? And now he is trying to paint this picture for these people who could be lacking hope because they're exiles. They're lacking hope because of all these things that are going on. And he points them, he says, as a result of your salvation, you get a future inheritance that is looks like this. It is amazing. It is an inheritance that is imperishable. That means it's incorruptible, indestructible. It never diminishes. It can't be damaged. This is such a foreign concept to us. Think about it. Our bodies, they fail every day. Think about the food that you eat. If you don't eat it, it perishes, except for maybe a Twinkie. But our treasured possessions, like our cars, what did they do? The tires rot. The frames rust. Everything around us is perishing. The homes that we have, it seems like there's constant update and repair that has to take place. And that he's reminding these people, your earthly inheritance that looked so good and looked so rewarding pales in comparison to the results of the, because of the means of your salvation, your hope in Jesus. You have an inheritance that's imperishable. Heaven is the opposite. It's without change, it's without end, it's eternal. It blows our minds. Bless the Lord for the inheritance that we have. Not only is it imperishable, it's undefiled, it's pure. Our inheritance has no stain. It's not able to be polluted. Undefiled means that there's no one getting this inheritance illegally or by a scam or settled in the court of law. This inheritance only comes if you have the hope, you've placed your hope, faith, and trust in Jesus Christ. He's the creator, he's the redeemer, he's the judge. He has provided a way for you to have this hope that is undefiled. As an heir of this, we need to bless the Lord. Then he says it's unfading. Man, living in Arizona for a little bit where that sun just beats down, it fades everything. It fades your skin, it fades your car, it fades the paint on your home. That sun withers stuff. And that's so not the picture of the earth or of the world, of the inheritance that is ours in heaven. Our inheritance in heaven is unfading. We only see stock markets fluctuate. We only see things twist and turn, and we never know where it's going to land. But he says that our future inheritance, one of the results of my salvation is my inheritance is imperishable, undefiled, unfading. Bless the Lord that we are heirs of an inheritance like that. And he doesn't stop. He says that it is kept in heaven for you. How personal is that? It's kept in heaven for you. Think about that Jesus is the one who's keeping watch. No one's getting by him. He's guarding your inheritance. It's better than any vault. It's better than any security box. It's better than any hiding place that you could come up with. No thief can crack the code. No hacker can get in. Heaven is kept for you. By Jesus. That inheritance, that's priceless. We as people should bless the Lord. That's where our hope is, in Jesus. It's personal. It's an inheritance set aside for you and for me. Do you have that hope in Jesus? I do. Well, when you consider the results of your salvation, and to think about all that God is doing in and through us and our church, maybe you find yourself feeling a little bit like an exile that just needs to have hope put back into your heart again. And it was mentioned that there are some ways for us to do that as a church. In the month of January, we want to be focusing on this word hope. How many of you would like to grow your hope? I want to grow my hope. I want my hope to grow deeper and deeper every day. And so here's some ways that if you are looking for hope to grow in your heart in the days ahead, here's some ways that you can be a part of a class, to be together with a group of people of like-mindedness, and maybe there'll be some who are looking for hope and they might experience it for the first time. But there are some classes all set aside just for you, online, free, that we might grow in this month of January in our hope, that it might be renewed, that it might be reinvigorated, that we might have our heart and our mind focus on this treasure of hope. It's an anchor, and we need that. Well, I want to encourage you with this third truth today. I have hope because of the permanence of my salvation. I have hope because of the permanence of my salvation. Look at verse 5. Who by God's power we are being guarded. Wow. Who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation that is ready and revealed in the last time. What a powerful verse. In the midst of a roller coaster ride, in the midst of difficulty, God's power, God's presence, God is always with us. He's the one who spoke the world into existence. And if all of that power is available to us because we are his children, that's amazing. Who by God's power, which is great, you need to remind yourself that he's got a grip on you and he's not letting go. And we're being guarded. I love the fact that he's guarding us, and the tense of this verb reveals that it's a constant on guard. There's no changing of the guard. There's no fraction of a second that he's not on guard for us. He is always with us. When you feel like the presence of the Lord is not near, he is. Just call out and ask for him. He promises to show himself in greater ways in these days ahead, but we have to lean into him. As different things come your way in 2021, will you let God be your guard? Will you let God be your shield to remind you of the permanence of the salvation? He is constantly with us. Dr. V said, the ultimate reason for our preservation must be God's great power manifested in his gift of grace for us. You know, we're not guarded from trials. So many people say, but man, this difficulty, yeah, that's a trial. And James chapter 1 says that when we experience trials of many kinds, it's to grow our faith, it's to grow our perseverance, it's to grow our steadfastness. And you know, inside of those trials, he's on guard with you because he's trying to guide you through them. He's trying to grow us to be deeper and more fond of who he is, that we might represent him better to other believers. We can come alongside those who are going through a trial because the Lord is with us and he's guiding us and is guarding us and he's got a shield around us and he's saying, here's the way to go during this trial. I love you. I care for you. The means of salvation, the results of salvation, and the permanence of salvation. He is never gonna leave us. Never. For salvation is ready to be revealed in the last time. I love that salvation is ready. It's not like, well, we have to wait for a certain time. It said that when he went to prepare a place for us, it's done. It's on the ready. When we are absent with the body, we are present with the Lord. And for some of you who lost loved ones this year, that's such a great promise to hang on to. Think about it. He never leaves us. We're with him forever. The permanence of our salvation. Some of you might be struggling. I don't know if I can make it to the end. Cling on to the permanence that the Lord is always with you. Cling on to the permanence that when you think, I am just going to walk away from all this, no, the presence of the Lord is with you. He will guide you. He will guard you. His salvation, then he says, will be made complete. When is that salvation going to be made complete? When he comes back to receive you, when he comes back at the end and he takes us to be in our heavenly home. Oh, we have so much to be thankful for. We have to be a people who walk into 2021 and say, bless the Lord, my hope is in him. The means of my salvation, the results of my salvation, the permanence of my salvation. And because of that, we shouldn't be a shy people. Peter's telling these folks before them, cling on to these truths because they're so important for you as you walk through this day. But don't keep them to yourself. And these people shared the hope of Jesus. I think about this past April, and I think about all that the Lord has done in the midst of the crazy pandemic that we're in. And it got all of us thinking here at Harvest, how can we be a church that's meeting the needs of people in our community? They need to have hope. Can I tell you about something that what's gonna start in 2021? And I want to encourage you to be a part of this in any way that you can. We're gonna start what's called the Hope Center. It's gonna be a place. I'm so excited about this because this is where we get to take the truths of God's word. And people are gonna come in believing that they need help in a tangible expression of food or some hygiene or eventually some clothing. That's what they believe because of the circumstances and the situations that they are facing are overwhelming. And we're gonna give stuff to them. But do you know what we can't wait to offer to them? Is for one of you to be able to open up the word and to say, but hope. Hope is in Jesus. Do you know when Pastor Ramirez and Claudia, who have really been the spearhead behind all of this, in April when we started meeting the needs of people and tangible expressions of food in our parking lot, we would have 200 cars on a given day. People, three or four people in a car. It went from just giving them an expression of love to an expression of hope. And do you know that we have fed over 8,000 families, I better get it right, 8,220 families here at Rolling Meadows. But better than that, I'm so thankful for those of you who have helped out, whether you've been praying for this or whether you have been an active participant in sharing this. 68 people now have a permanence of salvation because they put their hope in Jesus. They believe they were coming for this help. Yeah, we can applaud that. So church, we're ratcheting down our efforts. We're putting our focus on how can we be a part of bringing hope to people who have none, who are looking at their situations and feel totally overwhelmed and don't know what to do or where to turn. We can be a people who remind them of the means of salvation is Jesus. We can share with them the results of salvation and think about it, an imperishable, undefiled. It's not diminished. And it's kept by Jesus. And then we can tell them about the permanency, that God will always be with you. He's your guard. He's gonna protect you from the wicked one, and he's gonna guide and guard you through the trials that come in many different ways, in many different shapes, in many different sizes. Peter shares this with these people because they're in exile, very different than what they were used to. I don't know what 2021 has for us, but I do know that we have hope because of Jesus. And so that's what we can anchor on today. That's what we can cling on to. That's what we can walk into this new year with, hope because of Jesus. So I really want to finish our service off by singing about that hope. Ready? Let's stand to our feet. Kyle, would you lead us in the song?
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name.
Sing that again, bless the Lord.
Whatever may pass and what
Harvest, I'm so grateful for the living hope that we have in Jesus Christ that Pastor John reminded us of today. Hey, if we could pray for you before you go today, just reach out through the live prayer button or through the link in the comments. We want to care for you. We invite you to join us back here next Sunday at 9 and 11 a.m. And Harvest, just know that you are loved.